The main focus of colonization was to generate wealth. So what happens if none of these events took place in world history? What would Africa look like today? Considering the vast array of possibilities, it is nearly impossible to fathom the outcome. I hope you can permit me to start this alternate timeline from here. At the time of the 14th century, Europe was going through their dark ages, where they experienced famine, diseases, war, and a cascade of catastrophes. And a series of plagues, wiping out one-third of their population in the year 1348. 22 years before this time was Mansa Musa's pilgrimage. I assume you can reason how this would play out. Here is Africa, flaunting its wealth and immense riches in front of the whole world. Whilst in Europe, 25 million people have died. Have nothing to eat. To combat this, explorers from Europe were sent to various parts of the world to find wealth to bring back to Europe. The most famous of these explorers is Christopher Columbus. Amongst the destination of these European explorers was the African continent. Let me take a quick detour to the arrival of Europeans in the Americas. Upon their initial contact, they needed justification to excuse the conquest of their endeavors. Christianity was one of the tools that was used in their colonial subjugation. I am treading on thin ice here. I hope that in no way I am misconstrued, so I'd like to briefly state my opinion. I have absolutely nothing against Christianity. The only reason that I bring it up is because Christianity was a significant and recorded tactic Europeans used to conquer every new territory that they found themselves. In Africa, this didn't come easy because they met well-established kingdoms that were capable of defending themselves and also resistant to diseases that Europeans brought along with them. To conquer Africa warranted further justification, hence the process of rewriting history and tarnishing the image of Africa commenced. So they said that we were cannibals, savages, and fetish worshippers. This brings us to one of the most profound differences that we will experience if Africa was never colonized. Islam will be a dominant religion on the continent, seconded by Christianity, followed by indigenous African spirituality. It is a common misconception that Christianity was brought to Africa via colonization and European conquest. Through these methods is how the religion did spread across the continent, but Christianity has always had a home on the continent. In fact, Africa houses the oldest Christian nation in the world. Far, far before the time the Romans accepted Christianity, Ethiopia was the first Christian nation in the world. Christianity was not imposed on Ethiopia. In fact, guess where the Ark of the Covenant is currently? Ethiopia was the first kingdom on the planet to embrace Christianity. In Ethiopia, you'll find the oldest churches. You'll witness epic chapels such as the Abuma Yamadaga, also known as the Sky Chapel, carved 650 feet within a steep cliff. This is one of the landmarks of Christianity. In Ethiopia, you'll find the most epic churches out there. I digress. Islam would be a dominant religion on the continent because it was already here prior to European colonization and was quickly spreading around the continent. One of the reasons Islam and Christianity are the two dominant religions today is because of their intolerance of other religions or forms of spirituality. In other words, anything outside the beliefs of these religions is condemned, as opposed to African spirituality, which is fluid and more tolerant of several gods and deities. The take-home note here is, African spirituality will not be demonized the way that it is today, and will be a common practice on the continent. Anyone who views African spirituality via a negative lens, I implore you to do your own research on this topic. I assure you that it may not be what you have been made to believe. Several European explorers during the period of the colonial era have given their accounts on this issue, and have narrated of how Europe helped to cultivate this narrative to justify their conquest of Africa. A good example of one of these explorers is Leo Frobenius. I digress. This is usually around the time in which I insert a joke about pressing the thumbs up button, but Currently, I don't have any jokes, so I'll get straight to the point. 1 billion hours of YouTube videos are uploaded on the platform each day. The more likes a video gets, the more chances that video has to reach a newer audience. Pressing the thumbs up button tells YouTube that this is a video others might enjoy as well. One of the major contributors to a nation's economy is roads. You may have no idea, but roads play amongst, if not the biggest factor, in the creation of an economy. If you ever wonder why it is so expensive to travel within Africa, the short answer to that is roads. Even if you're traveling by air, the answer to that is still roads. Considering the lag and the delay that colonization has brought to the continent, Africa is playing catch up to the world when it comes to roads. Dating back to pre-colonial Africa, we know of several empires with well-established transport networks. Unfortunately, during the colonial era, these roads were reconstructed to lead to coastal cities. Europeans at the time praised the well-developed roads in kingdoms like the Asante Empire. For example, these roads required extensive labor and maintenance to be made and taken care of. These roads would have been developed into modern roads as we know today. They would have been strategic, linking important landmarks within the community. Unlike during the colonial era, where train tracks and roads only led to the coastal cities from resources-rich areas in order to take resources out of Africa. Contrary to that, Africa would have developed the indigenous roads, easing the transport of goods and services within the continent, thereby establishing and solidifying a powerful economy. We have seen documented accounts of European travelers in regards to well-developed transportation networks. So it is safe to assume that just like the rest of the world, these roads would have developed over time, expanded, and modernized over time, linking even more strategic points from city to city. This will be the premise of an extensive economy. Without colonization, there probably wouldn't be any of the world wars, and if there were, Africa would have no part of it. A lot of people are not aware, but Africa played a pivotal role in both World War I and II. It's quite unfortunate that we fought in wars that had nothing to do with us, and our sacrifices still till this day go unacknowledged. More than 80,000 Senegalese were called to France to fight. Subsequently, an additional 100,000 Africans fought under the French flag. Britain recruited over 300,000 Africans, the list goes on. March 14, 1941. The fastest military retreat in human history took place, where Nigerians chased away the Italians for 1,000 kilometers in 10 days. And the only reason Nigeria didn't go any further was because we ran out of supplies. It's unfortunate that a lot of Nigerians don't know this aspect of Nigerian history. The Italians didn't want no smoke with Nigeria. Nigeria was like, "Why are you running? Why are you running?" Did I just change my entire outfit just so that I can say this one sentence? Yes, I did. The funny part about that is most of my audience is not Nigerian and will not understand that reference. Also, this is probably not going to be as funny as I planned it to be. The things I do to try to get you guys to press the thumbs up button. An important thing to mention is that if Africa was not colonized, how significant of an impact that will play on our educational system. One of the ways Europe undermined the African continent was to say that civilization began in Greek societies. But they were fully aware that everything that the Greeks knew, they learned from Africa. How do we know this? Well, the Greeks said that themselves. They also mentioned that Ethiopia was a special place where people lived forever and where Greek gods went to renew their strength and to eat feast of sheep and bulls. I say this not to undermine the accomplishments of Greek societies. I say this because it is the natural order of things. An older civilization will always have more to offer to a newer one. European scholars caught themselves within the web of their own bullshit, knowing that a lot of Greek scientists spent a substantial amount of time in Africa learning underneath the guidance of African scholars. To combat this, Europe said Egypt, alongside societies in the Nile Valley, are just an extension of European civilization. Think about it. This is a lie still evident today. I hate to use this term, but I will use it because it reflects the matter precisely. The whitewashing of North Africa started a long, long time ago. A lot of modern science holds its basis on Greek scholars. Many Greek scientists spent decades in Africa studying. A good example of this is Pythagoras, the mathematician that we all love to hate. Pythagoras spent 23 years in Egypt studying under the guidance of King Amasis II before he went to build schools in Greece. Pythagoras has an entire branch of mathematics named and dedicated to him, the Pythagorean theorem. Considering that the Pythagorean theorem is one of the key elements needed in the construction of the pyramids we see in Egypt and Sudan, it is evident where his inspiration as well as the inclination of a lot of Greek scholars came from. This segues us to an important point. Science has a tradition of acknowledging pioneers in a particular discipline. We have the father of physics, Galileo, the father of mathematics, Archimedes, who, by the way, was Greek. What I'm trying to say is, throughout my duration in school, I've never seen an African being referenced as a pioneer of any discipline or even any of the contribution that Africa has made to society as we know today. That's not by accident. African history has been fashioned in a manner to remain hidden to us in order to justify our enslavement. I can only imagine that if colonization took place, how much of African scientists and scholars would be acknowledged today for their achievements in science and other fields. Today in Yoruba culture, we have the father of metal by the name of Tobe Ode, the first man to discover iron, and he used it to save his people. He was a real person, but unfortunately, his legacy has been demonized, and he is currently viewed largely by our people as an incubus. A lot of historians are convinced that iron was independently and discovered first in West Africa. The importance of African contribution via education is important. It plays a significant and psychological role in our lives. It is dangerous that our contribution is not reflected in any education system around the world. If the contrary was so and colonization never occurred, this will impact our racial esteem significantly. It will affect the way that we view each other. Many may not admit it, but we suffer from an innate inferiority complex, which stems from us having no reference of contributions that our ancestors made to modern society. What's left is a void. A feeling of emptiness, solidified by the notion that we were nothing until the arrival of Europeans. In a way, it makes us feel insignificant, and that is the harsh reality. So, if colonization never took place, how will slavery play out in Africa, considering that slavery was already a common practice on the continent? To tackle this, we must be open-minded and dispel many of the things that we were taught, because the misconceptions behind African slave trade is overwhelming. Words evolve over time and may even adopt an alternate meaning from its original definition. For example, did you know that the word nice at some point in time meant ignorant, foolish, stupid, void of reasoning? And the word silly at some point meant blessed with worthiness. On a similar note, think of the word slave and what picture that paints in your mind. Are you thinking of someone who is property? Someone not regarded as a human? Someone with no hopes of attaining freedom? Well, throw that concept away, because that was not what was going on in Africa. This was one of the fallacies propagated to justify colonization. So they said that Africans participated in slavery, so there was no difference when Europeans came over and did the same. We don't hear of the notion of Europeans enslaving each other, even though they did extensively, and there is good reason for that. We have acknowledged that Europe is diverse, consisting of several different kingdoms and tribes. Let me know in the comments if you saw what I just did there. African diversity is hardly ever a factor in this matter, but understand that Nigeria alone has more diversity than the entirety of Europe combined. Yes, there was slavery prior to European conquest, but it was not the same. It became exaggerated upon European arrival, where they created a market for it, which was one of the tactics of their conquest. Prior to their arrival, slaves were still viewed as humans, and we had laws set in place to protect slaves. Laws in which, if violated, can lead to severe punishment and even the death penalty. It was a constitution called the Corocanfoga. Article 5 of the Corocanfoga states, "Everybody has the rights to life and the preservation of physical integrity. Accordingly, any attempts to deprive one's fellow being of life is punished by death." And Article 20 states, "Do not ill-treat the slave. Let them rest one day per week and to end their day at a reasonable time. You are the master of the slave and not the bag that he carries." I don't want to go into too much detail on this topic because I've already covered it in a previous video. Stay till the end of this video to be redirected to that video. The take-home message here is that a lot of people would argue that Africa would end up falling apart due to slavery, but they completely ignore the systems that we put in place to prevent this from happening. Just like every other civilization, slavery at some point would have dissolved over time. So without the market of the transatlantic slave trade, this means that there will be no such thing as diaspora, and the greatest minds of Africa will remain on the continent to make improvements upon the continent. I do believe that Africa would end up being a superpower. The reason I say that is because prior to colonization, that's what she was. On top of that, there will be no free labor or human resources used to develop other nations, thereby solidifying Africa as the center of global trade and power. Before I head over to the last point of how Africa would look like if it was never colonized, I'd like to say something very important. It will be remiss of me if I don't mention my unconscious bias, as its name implies unconscious. There's no way anyone can properly identify their own personal prejudice. Hence, I rely on the opinion of perspectives that is different from mine to reason with. Also, I am aware of the level of bias and wishful thinking this video holds. I say this because there is no way anyone can accurately and precisely list out the events that will take place if Africa was never colonized. There's so much more that I'd like to speak on in regards to this topic, but there's very limited time. This video has already well exceeded the time I am permitted for a video, and I can only say so much within a limited time frame. Let me know in the comments below if you have an alternate timeline. If not for colonization, I believe that our history will be preserved and celebrated. It will be something taught in our schools, unlike today where our history is hardly ever taught to us. A large bulk of our history is outside of the continent. You'll find it in museums in Europe and also in the homes of wealthy European collectors. In my video, "Should African Art Go Back to Africa?", I went into detail of how 90% of Asian African artifacts and artwork are held in Europe. And I will add on to that, that the vast majority of our history is also held outside of the continent. To learn more about our history, we must visit libraries and museums in Europe. Artists, for example, on the African continent are left to draw their inspiration through pictures of African art that are in museums in Europe. Not only that, our museums on the continent hold a replica of the original. One fact of colonization that often goes untold is what happens to a kingdom that doesn't comply to the colonial conquest. Such kingdoms are burnt to the ground. A good example of this is the Benin Empire, which was completely looted and burnt to the ground. You'll find the remains of the Benin Empire in Europe. Whilst in Benin, there's very little reverence to what was once their culture. Benin refused to trade with Britain because they knew that Britain had ulterior motives. Their suspicion was verified after Robert Phillips was caught trying to sneak a force of 250 soldiers into the capital of Benin. All 250 were killed. The British retaliated through an invasion and burning the city to the ground, looting everything that they found valuable. A lot of these artifacts are still in museums in Europe and also in the homes of wealthy European collectors. Without colonization, a huge portion of our history will be preserved. Even our written language in a similar manner will be preserved, and over time would have evolved to become more sophisticated. These written languages will be well established and used in various societies around the continent. A lot of our traditional writing are still in use today, but many went extinct during colonial conquest. Click this video to find out how this African artwork sold for over $10 million. I'll see you then.